Thank you. And if I could just take a quick moment out and say a special thanks to the Sharq Forum, especially the hardworking staff, Shireen, Firdaus, Nuseiba, for accommodating us, and yourselves for making it through, really, to dedicate the time and energy to be in a forum like this, to travel around the world. It really hands off to you. I'm going to make my presentation brief, but I'd like you to follow along with me. I have 3 points, really, that I'm going to be carrying this conversation through, and that is, let us look at pluralism through practice. Pluralism through practice. I want us to recognize that the solution to our problems is often in the problem, and I'd also like you to know that you can learn a lot from a river. So let us begin. Right now, the question about pluralism is one that dominates our headlines, our own political discussions, our civil society. But pluralism as a concept, just like our brother Jaffer said earlier, like tolerance, is an imported concept, an ethical virtue that is born in a particular historical moment. And while that is good, there are better solutions. Pluralism is a concept that comes out of a particular political thinking that is post-Lockean. So the best examples that you can find about a pluralistic argument already presume a deep and accepted secularism. That concept is as inapplicable to our societies as the practice of enforced secularism has been on our societies. So a better solution, in my mind, is not for us to think about what could pluralism look like, or what should pluralism look like, but I'll ask you, what does pluralism look like? What is pluralism today in our societies? And many of you, by proof of your hands, show that you don't believe that pluralism exists, but I would beg to differ. Everybody in this room has family members that come from a different pluralistic ideological background. One step away in your backgrounds and your families, you have a separate sectarian background, okay? You also have gender pluralism. You live pluralism every day in your families, in your neighborhoods, in your local lives. Let's macro just a little bit. In the midst of all of this madness in our region, and it's a hard time right now, I understand. I'm not by any means trying to downplay the existence of sectarian strife and violence. It's very real in our region. But let me ask you, why hasn't Kuwait descended into chaos? Why hasn't Lebanon, faced with an increase of 30% of its population, okay, with the troubles that that society has had, why hasn't it triggered another civil war? I will tell you that there are answers there that we have yet to explore. The solution is in the problem. Let's think. Right now, a forum like this, youth-oriented, does not want to focus on the problem. That's a very good thing. Most of you, most of your colleagues, most of your peers are anti-sectarian. Fooling through in your own personal lives, in your marriages, and in your social relations. You are anti-sectarianism. But I would say that there's a better solution, and that is, you can never escape sectarianism, because sectarianism, nationalism, ideology, as much as we wish that it were gone, it's still there. It's like chlorine or alkaline in your water. You have to explore it, you have to find it, you have to know that it's there. I would say, much like the movie Halala Wayne, have you seen this by Nadine Labaki? Who has seen that film? Where do we go now? We will never escape these identities, so let us try to identify as ways that we have already dealt with them. In the middle of sectarianism in Iraq, the last thing in the world you want to hear is that Iraq somehow provides a solution. We hear about the sectarian strife. We hear about ethnic, you know, cleansing on the level of ethnic cleansing in Baghdad after the invasion. But let me ask you, do we hear about the humanitarian cooperation between tribes, between sects, across religious lines that's taking place today in Iraq, all across the region? I want to know, what are the tools that they're drawing upon that we can learn from? Rather than us thinking about what should, could be, let us think about what is working. The same thing is happening here in Turkey. I've traveled across the border region, and I've seen faith-based organizations, Christian, Muslim of all kinds of different backgrounds, Sufi, Sunni, Ikhwani, I've seen them all working together, Kurdish, Arab, Turkish, working together in the quest for an insaniya, a kind of new humanism that our brother also spoke about. So let us think now. If we're looking at the present moment, Let us not get flooded. Let us not throw away the history. We all say that history is important. It's important to read history not just because you're bound to repeat its mistakes if you don't read it, but because you will likely get lost if you don't know history. And what I mean by that is that it is good that you want to embrace the future. It is a very good thing that you're not afraid of the future and that you want to move forward, but it's a bad thing if you want to act like the past doesn't affect you. The future is now, and we already have answers in front of us. We go back to historical examples where we find a Muslim humanism. It was amazing to me when I heard about the emerging humanism that can be born out of different theoretical paradigms. When I was in Kilis recently, I was meeting with a humanitarian worker. He was a furniture store owner. He was a businessman who had dedicated a number of his properties to house some orphans and their families. I asked him, what motivates you? What's your background? What are you reading? And he looked at me and he said, now imagine the magic that it took this. He said, I read Ali Shariati. I read Hassan al-Banna. I read Maududi, Sayyid Qutb, and Ayatollah Khomeini. Anybody who can put those in the same sentence, you know, hats off to you. He said, they all said one thing, but Maulana said it 1,000 years ago, and today we learned Ibn Miskaway also said it, insan, insan, insan. The emerging humanism that we're all looking for, that we're all thinking about, that we're all dreaming about, is right in front of us. I would argue that the solutions you dream about in the future have existed, exist now, and you have yet to look at them. Our brother Darren today spoke about Bitcoin. Imagine this. You know, Bitcoin, blockchain technology. How many of you have heard of the Hawala transfer system? The Hawala transfer system has been around for 1,000 years in this part of the region. It is a pre-modern Bitcoin, Western Union, and today, in the most remote parts of the world where there isn't running water, where there isn't electricity, and we don't benefit from e-commerce, and we don't benefit from an e-oriented future, we have classic institutions that are carrying through and providing UN-level, DFID-level humanitarian aid using this ancient institution. It's not just an idea to say that we go back to our legacy and we think about this. The institutions today that are serving the most vulnerable in our part of the world have been in existence, and we're not paying attention to them in the quest of some kind of dream for the future. The future is today. So in closing, I want to challenge Al-Sharq to bring together some of the amazing opportunities and nodes that we see before us. Imagine a situation just today where we could map pluralism. I guarantee you that it wouldn't take much for Sharq organizers right now to talk to our dear sister Heather Lesson and come up with one quick application. I'm sure we could do it. Let us map the lessons of pluralism that we have. By tomorrow afternoon, I guarantee you we could have 1,000 real examples harnessing the collective power in this room, not just as an abstract idea, but as a real living example for us to look at what already works, what is already successful, and let us use that to be our aid and not some kind of abstract notion. Thank you very much.